Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
Good morning, and welcome to First Baptist Church of Morrisville on this lovely Palm Sunday outside. And what a great season to have time to pause and reflect as we enter this Holy Week and can think about our Savior, the sacrifice he gave for us, and the love he has for us through today. So we invite you to continue on with us, join with us in worship as we do some tech magic and pull back some worship now.
Precious cornerstone, sure foundation, you are faithful. church, let the righteousness of God be a holy flame that burns. Let the saving love of Christ be the measure of our lives. We believe you're up to us. Let the glory of the name be the passion of the church. Let the righteousness of God be a holy flame that burns. Let the saving love of Christ be the measure of our lives. We believe you're all to us. When this passing world is over,
help us this morning as we come to lay everything at your feet, to not put it aside because you know we can't wipe it out of our minds and stop thinking about it, but Lord, help us to lay it at your feet so our focus is on you and you are all to us. That when we leave this place, those things may still be existing in our lives, but they'll be at your feet and in your hands. And you will be everything to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones. The joy I own. Brokenness and pain is all I know. I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand. Doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lie. Doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear
So a few announcements as we continue in this season. The first one is welcome again. Thank you for being with us. We have a special Sunday here on this Palm Sunday. We will be doing communion at the end of the service, so make sure you stick around for that. And if you have not yet prepared to try and grab some of the elements that you can do yourself, I was thinking about the closest you could get would possibly be like a donut, you know. But whatever you have around that would work, we will do that at the end. You can either pause and join us, or if you're already ready, I know we've been preparing for a special quarantine home church celebration, so looking forward to that at the end of the service. But welcome. During this time of social distancing, if you would like to socially engage with us, you can see from our website there are a number of ways to do that. We have the video sermons, which is the series of messages going back through history that you can watch when you have time. There is also the prayer link. If you need prayer, you can submit that on there, and that will come out. You can also email the prayer team at prayer@fbcmorrisville.org and let them know if you have a request that you'd like them to pray for but not be published. Just send them an email, and they will do that. There's the Contact Us button as well, where you can reach the elders and pastor, and obviously, nobody is here at the church throughout the week or even this morning answering the phone, but you can get in touch with us. And there is also the giving button there. And so for our regular attenders and givers, excuse me, thank you for being so faithful during this unique time. We've had reports from our church financial secretary that offerings are coming in, and so we very much appreciate you doing these various methods to give. You can drop it off here at the church. If you have a bill pay where they will mail it to the church, that works as well. And then also through the giving tab, which you saw earlier on the church website, you can use that as well. But if you're joining with us, welcome. Watch the video, enjoy. If you do not have a church you're regularly supporting through your tithe, you're welcome to give as well. Next, a reminder, we also have the Right Now Media access. So Right Now Media is a collection of online messages, video clips, studies that you can go through and do. And it's normally a paid service, but through the church we have access to that. If you do not have access, again, use that Contact Us, shoot Pastor Gary or the elders a message, and we will get you signed up. You can enjoy that. Lots of stuff on there for the kids. I know there's been a lot of talk about kids and what do we do with them. So this is one great thing that you can do, is get them engaged that way. Another way to socially engage during this physical distancing is through our life groups. Those are continuing, although as you will see, virtually now at 7 p.m., Monday through Wednesday of this week. Normally they've been trying to have them every night. By computer or cell phone, if you use the Chrome browser, go to the link that's on there, the /FBCM/LG life group. Makes sense. And if you use the cell phone app, it's just as easy. You can type in that URL and you're there. Or on the cell phone app, get the 8x8 video meeting. There's a small enter as a guest link. You click on that, you type in the FBCM/LG again. You don't have to worry about the rest of the URL from above. And you just hit the join the meeting, and you're in with whoever else is there, and you can see them and talk to them and come back and forth. And finally, in this special Holy Week, we have a number of ways that you can continue to join with us and fellowship with us throughout this. On Thursday, we will have a Maundy Thursday service with Model Ballaston, who will go through Christ in the Passover with us. So watch our website or the Facebook page for links to the service, and it will be another communion service. So in some way today, if you're not used to doing communion services at home, which I don't believe a lot of people normally do, you can think of today as a dry run for the Holy Thursday celebration. And then on Good Friday, there is a service happening from noon to 2 p.m. Again, watch the church website and the Facebook page, and the seven last words of Christ will be presented by young men from our church as well as young men from the Calvary Baptist Church in Bristol. So thank you again for joining us. Let's take a quick prayer as we watch a video, and then Pastor Gary will be up to give us the message today. Father, we do thank you that you are always faithful, that, Lord, once we are your children, you are forever our Father, and you never leave us. And no matter what happens, no matter what situations or circumstances come through, or, Lord, whatever we even try and do sometimes, nothing can separate us from your love and take us out of your hand. We thank you for the remembrances we have at this Easter season, that Jesus came, he rose again, but first he died on the cross. And Lord, our sins are something terrible, but we thank you that you take away our sins, you wash us, you make us new, you make us new creatures from the inside out. And with this, we can serve others and live through everything, including this current time of the COVID-19. We thank you again for being with us. Help us now to concentrate and understand as we look at your word, and continue to learn more about you and grow as we study and worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Standing close to Jesus' cross were his mother, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing there.
Here's your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
she is your mother.
From that time, the disciple took her to live in his home. Jesus knew that by now everything had been completed. And in order to make the scripture come true, he said,
I am thirsty.
A bowl was there, full of cheap wine. So a sponge was soaked in the wine, put on a stalk of hyssop, and lifted up to his lips. Jesus drank the wine.
It is finished.
Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Then the Jewish authorities asked Pilate to allow them to break the legs of the men who had been crucified and to take the bodies down from the crosses. They requested this because it was Friday, and they did not want the bodies to stay on the crosses on the Sabbath, since the coming Sabbath was especially holy. So the soldiers went and broke the legs of the first man, and then of the other man, who had been crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead, so they did not break his legs. One of the soldiers, however, plunged his spear into Jesus' side. And at once, blood and water poured out. The one who saw this happen has spoken of it, so that you may also believe. What he said is true, and he knows that he speaks the truth. This was done to make the scripture come true. Not one of his bones will be broken. And there is another scripture that says, people will look at him whom they pierced. After this, Joseph, who was from the town of Arimathea, asked Pilate if he could take Jesus' body. Joseph was a follower of Jesus, but in secret because he was afraid of the Jewish authorities. Pilate told him he could have the body, so Joseph went and took it away. Nicodemus, who at first had gone to see Jesus at night, went with Joseph, taking with him about 100 pounds of spices, a mixture of myrrh and aloes. The two men took Jesus' body and wrapped it in linen cloths with the spices, according to the Jewish custom of preparing a body for burial. There was a garden in the place where Jesus had been put to death, and in it there was a new tomb where no one had ever been buried. Since it was the day before the Sabbath, and because the tomb was close by, they placed Jesus' body there.
Dear Lord, we want to come to prayer this morning and just thank you for this wonderful day, and also a day in which we look at a tragedy that took place in human eyes. It's a beautiful Palm Sunday morning outside, and we have the palms here representing the branches that the people threw down in front of Jesus Christ, welcoming him as king. And yet today's sermon is the last half of John 19, where they crucify their king. Today we're also in a very difficult situation here in the United States and around the world. We want to ask for you to just watch over those of us who are believers and actually the entire world, but especially those of us who are believers, that we may be able to reach out and respond to needs around us by our neighbors and then take care of our own families. We want to especially think of Pastor Rob and Jeannie up in Brooklyn, who preach here once a month, and their situation as they're locked down and not able to get out to visit people that have the virus, and there are people dying all around them, and we just know that it's a difficult situation for them, but we do bring them to prayer. We also want to remember those that are first responders and frontline medical personnel as they continue to minister to those who have this virus, protect them, and we ask that they might be able to be effective, and that soon there will be some sort of a shot or a medicine or something that will help us quell this. But as we go through this, we ask for your grace in our lives. We pray for our government officials as they make decisions that are difficult and sometimes hard, and for our economy, which has definitely suffered, and people who have lost jobs and money is tight. We ask that you'll just watch over each of those and help us to be able to get through this and to recognize that our trust and our reliance is not on the medicines and on the doctors and on the money, but it's on you, our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. As we come now to look at the scripture, we ask that you might help us all to understand the part that you play in this role of salvation. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we want to welcome you to First Baptist this morning and to the sermon, and we're going to be in the second half of John chapter 19, and I'd encourage you to take your Bibles, turn with that passage, if you would, at home, or if you do it on your cell phone, however you look at the Bible. I'd encourage you to take your Bible and just take a look at this particular section that we're going to look at today. And in this particular section, we're going to have three parts. We're going to look at the final words that Jesus gave. We're also going to look at his final breath, and then at his final resting place. And we'd like to start off with his final words. And if you take your Bibles and look at it, in verses 25 to 30, there are three words. And we have I put on the slides here for you to look at, the seven last words of Christ. Now, on Friday afternoon from 12 to 2, we're going to live stream. Some will be from their homes, and some will be from the church. But we're going to live stream seven final words, and six of our young men, one old guy, not me, are going to go through these seven verses and explain them a little bit more to us and give their thoughts. And we encourage you to look and to encourage these young men as they are attempting to share their thoughts with us, each for 12 minutes approximately, and we're going to go through these seven words. Of the three that are in yellow are the three words that our gentleman from First Baptist will be highlighting, and the other ones will be a gentleman from Calvary Baptist in Bristol. And three of these words, as you can see, that are highlighted, they're in the book of John. And our men will be doing 3, 5, and 7 this year at it. But 3, 4, 5, and 6 are actually in our passage today. And so that gives you a little bit of an overview. Father, forgive them. Today you'll be with me in paradise. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? I am thirsty. It is finished. And then, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And we're going to go through these three that are in yellow because they're in our text, but I'm not going to go real detailed into them because I want you to come back on Friday afternoon from 12 to 2, watch our live stream for our videos, and watch these gentlemen share their hearts with you briefly about each one of these words. But if you'll take your Bibles, let's look at them briefly. And the first one is his mom, verses 25, the second half of it, to verse 27. And I call this thinking of others because he was on the cross in excruciating pain, and Pastor Van Zandt last week talked to us about the extreme pressure, the extreme pain that Jesus Christ has gone through, was going through. And it's interesting that on the cross, the third word, he's thinking of his mom. He's thinking of others, not himself. And in this particular section, again, I'm not going to go into the details of this, but the scriptures tell us in Matthew 27:55, many women were there to look on from a distance who had followed Jesus. But there are four that are mentioned in the Synoptic Gospel. There's only three mentioned. John is the only one that mentions Jesus Christ's mom. And so if we look at the next slide here, I just want to give you an overview of who these ladies were who were at the cross. Not part of the distant women that were standing there. There were many other distant women standing out there watching on that had ministered to Jesus. But these three particularly are mentioned, and then his mom in John. So in yellow, we have Mary Magdalene. We all know her. And I'm not going to go again into detail on each of these women. But if you take your Bible and you want to look them up, you can study them. Go on BibleGateway.com or the Bible app, and you can search for each of these women and find out more about each one. Mary Magdalene had seven demons thrown out of her, cast out of her by Jesus, and was much indebted to him. And so consequently, she was one of the ones that loved him dearly. You also find her at the tomb as we look at that next week. But Mary Magdalene was one. The other is Mary, the mother of James, and Joseph. She is mentioned second in the two other Gospels that mention them. We believe that that's Mary, the wife of Clopas, in this particular section we look at in John chapter 19. Then there was Salome, the mother of Zebedee's children. Zebedee was her husband, and that's James and John, and she comes in quite a bit also. And in this particular scenario, because of this, we can't prove it, but we believe that the Salome, or the mother of Zebedee, who's mentioned in Matthew and in Mark, are the one and the same individual, because she's noticed as being close to the cross. And John also mentions her, but he calls her his mother's sister. If that be true, then his mother's sister is actually the mother of James and John. So John, who she sees at the cross, is actually a cousin of Jesus. And then the fourth person who we can concentrate on in this particular section in John chapter 19, verse 25, is Mary herself. You might ask, why John? Why not Joseph? Well, he doesn't appear. He was probably an older gentleman at their marriage, more mature, and so she was rather young, so we believe that possibly he was deceased. And, of course, the other brothers, according to John 7, 5, were not believers, and so they weren't there. So Jesus gives care of his mom to his possible cousin, John. And then second verse that we have here is he looks at himself in verses 28 and 29, and that's his suffering for us. So first of all, he looks to think of others. Now he thinks of, and I don't think he's thinking of himself, and you can check in Friday and get a little bit more explanation as to why he possibly says, I'm thirsty, although that is something that he needs, but I think there's a reason why he asks for water at this particular point because of what follows it. And I just like to say that these things that happen in agony on the cross, I don't think he's thinking, what can I fulfill in prophecy? But as you look at the Old Testament, you find that these things were actually predicted in the Old Testament. When he says this in Psalm 69:21, it says, they also gave me gall for my food, and for my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink. Again, Psalms looking forward to the cross. And then in Psalm 22:15, chapter 22, Psalm 22 is one that you really should look at. It describes so much in detail this crucifixion method, which was not even known at the time Psalms were written in the time of David. But one of the verses says, my strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaves to my jaws, and you lay me in the dust of death. And so even in this psalm, it's talking about him being so thirsty and wanting water, and my throat's getting dry, and so I'm going to take a drink right now myself of beautiful water. When your throat gets dry, you really need water, don't you? I don't know if you've ever been in the Army. I used to have to run the two-mile run and once a year, and I will tell you, your throat gets dry, and when you finish up, all you want to do is get some water and sit down and rest. He refused this actually before the crucifixion, at the beginning of the crucifixion. If you look at Matthew 27 and 34 and Mark 15, 23, he had refused to actually take some sort of beverage for his throat to wet his whistle, you might say. But here he asks for it, and so there's a reason. And you'll have to tune back on Friday from 12 to 2 in order to find that answer. The third word that he says is, it is finished, and that's in verse 30. And it's recorded in verse 30 here. And I think it's fine if the question is, what is finished? And again, I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail because I want these guys on Friday to be able to share that with you and not steal any thunder from them. But I do want to mention that when I think of it as finished, I think of two other verses. One is Matthew 1:21. This was spoken to Joseph himself. When he was considering, should I divorce Mary or should I keep her? I mean, she's a child that's not mine. And Matthew 1:21 says, and she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for it is he who will save his people from their sin. From the very beginning, Jesus came to the world for this purpose. It is finished. And then, of course, he's in Luke 19:10, one of my favorite verses when I was a kid growing up, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save those who are lost. This morning, as we continue through this sermon and what Jesus Christ experienced here, and I just want to ask you, are you one of those who is lost? Do you need to be found? Because you could be found today. Tune back in on Friday. get a little more detail in these words, but these are three of the seven last words, and they're from the book of John. Now we want to move into verses 30, the second half of 30, into 37. And the first half, the last part of this verse, it says, it is finished, and it says, and he bowed up his spirit, and bowed his head, and gave up his spirit, or gave up the ghost. He gave up the life that was in him. And so we find his final breath taking place here in verse 30. And as we look at verses 35 through, 30b through 37, there are a few things of interest here. In verses 31 through 33, it says that his legs were not broken. And as you saw on the slides, on the picture, as the text was read and visualized for you earlier, this was quite excruciating. The day was a very special day, this Sabbath, that was coming up on Saturday, and Jesus Christ had just died. It was on Friday, so he was to be in the tomb for 3 days, part of Friday, Saturday, and then part of Sunday morning. And as we read this, it says that the two thieves had their legs broken. The Jews, while they were being very meticulous and killing the Messiah, wanted to make sure that the thieves and the ones that were on the crosses were dead before the Sabbath began, if you can believe that. And so in order to do this, oftentimes with crucifixion, the way a person survived, and they could survive for 2 or 3 days on the cross, the way they survived was they would push themselves up with their feet. So they'd be on the cross, and they wouldn't be able to breathe, and as they had their hands up, they'd push themselves up to catch a breath. And then they'd push themselves up to catch a breath. And by the Roman soldiers coming in with an iron mallet, as very accurately portrayed, as you saw in there, they take an iron mallet, and they just smash their shins. I don't know if you've ever been hit in the shins. It hurts, you know. An accident, you fall, you hit your shin, or you run into something you didn't see, and you hit your shin bone. Oh, what pain. Can you imagine these two thieves on the cross, and they walk up with iron mallets, large hammers, and just smash their shins, smash their legs, so that they can no longer lift themselves to breathe. And very soon they die in their own fluids, much like pneumonia. And they can't breathe anymore, and they asphyxiate and pass away. And so these two thieves, that took place. But the text very clearly, and John points us out very clearly, as he says, he wound up coming to Jesus in verse 33. When they saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Now, there's a couple of things I want to point out here. First of all, he was crucified at 9 a.m. He dies at 3 p.m., according to different texts that we have. That's the time that he was on the cross. But in John chapter 1, verses 29 and 36, John the Baptist calls Jesus out as he's walking by early on in his ministry. And he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." John the Baptist is comparing Jesus Christ to the Paschal Lamb, the Passover Lamb, or to a lamb that's sacrificed in the temple for the sins. And it's noted that as you look at them, and we'll look at this in just a few seconds, but legs or the bones of the lamb were not allowed to be broken. The lamb was to be a perfect sacrifice, perfect in all cases. And Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, was perfect in every case, without sin and without flaw. And he was paid the penalty, not for his own sin, because he had none, but for yours and for mine. And then later on in 1 Corinthians 5:7, Paul says, "Clean out the old leaven." Leaven is a symbol of sin, and when we partake of the communion, and if you're partaking at home, maybe a cracker or something at home without leaven, that's really what they used. It's from matzah, and sin should be associated with this, and so consequently they baked their bread without yeast or without leaven in order to make it very flat, like we typically have in our communion services. And so if you're using a cracker, you're probably closer than if you're using a piece of bread, but use whatever you happen to have available at this particular point. Clean out the old leaven, it says, so that you may be a new lump, just as you are in fact unleavened. For Christ our Passover also has been sacrificed. So Paul himself, again, in 1 Corinthians, is indicating that Jesus Christ is like the Passover lamb. And that's why, particularly, it was interesting, and it's made note, that his legs were not broken. And then as we look at this, verses 34 and 35, it says here, "But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately there came out blood and water. And he who has seen has become witness, has borne witness, and his witness is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you also may believe." Why is Jesus Christ doing this? Why is John doing this in this particular section? Because he wants you to know one thing. There's been a lot of discussion. Dr. Stuart Bergsma is one that has written a lot on this, and others have. And some feel that the water and blood was separated because there was a ruptured heart. So they say, well, he had a broken heart, or that's what he died, that's when he gave up the ghost, that's what happened, the heart ruptured. That could be one explanation, but I'm not as concerned about what caused the water and blood to separate in his blood, or whatever, both of them come out when the spear went in. John did this in order to demonstrate and make sure that we knew Jesus was dead, D-E-A, dead. If you pierce a person's side, you're not going to get water separated from blood. You're going to get blood. I'm not going to demonstrate this morning, but just trust me, blood will come out. John wanted to make it very clear here so that nobody could later on say that it's wrong, and he's saying this is an eyewitness account. I was there. It was kind of interesting. At the cross, there were many women there, but there was only one man. Only one of the disciples showed up, and that was John. And he says, I bear witness, water and blood separate came out of the wound. He was pierced. And the third reason why I think it's unclear that John brings out these two things is what I call prophecy fulfilled. And if you look again at the slide, prophecy fulfilled, we want to look at verses 36 and 37. And so as we look at verses 36 and 37, it says, for these things came to pass that the scripture might be fulfilled, not a bone of him shall be broken. And again, another scripture says, they shall look upon him whom they have pierced. So these two events were important because they fulfilled scripture. So if you look at scripture, you'll find in Psalm 34:20, it says, he keeps all his bones, not one of them is broken. A psalm referring forward to this particular case. And then if you look in Exodus and in Numbers, it talks about the sacrificial lamb that I spoke of earlier. It is the sacrificial lamb, the Passover lamb, is to be eaten in a single house. You are not to bring forth any of the flesh outside of the house, nor are you to break any bone of it. Exodus 12:46. And then Numbers 9:12. They shall leave none of it until morning, nor break a bone of it, according to all the statutes of Passover. They shall observe it. So it was important that Jesus Christ's legs not be broken because he was a picture of the Passover lamb. This is not something he could have predicted. This is not something Jesus Christ could have tried to say, I'm going to do this because the Old Testament said this. This was a fulfillment of prophecy that John witnessed. And then also it says in Zechariah 12:10, if you look at the Old Testament, this is God speaking, which again demonstrates that Jesus Christ was in fact God. In Zechariah 12:10, it says, they will look on me whom they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only son, and they will weep bitterly over him like the bitter weeping over a firstborn. So the pierced side was also a prediction that God said would happen to him himself as he was on the cross. As we look at the Old Testament and all these predictions, you can take a look, and there's 332 Old Testament prophecies. If you want to say, what's the chance of all those 322 prophecies coming true? It would be this. 1 in 84 chances. Not just 84, though. With 100 zeros after it. One chance in 84 with 100 zeros, and I don't even know what that is. That's the chance of fulfilling all 322 prophecies in the Old Testament. And yet Jesus Christ, the Messiah, fulfilled them all. And so this morning, as we come to the final conclusion, just after this third point, the question is for you, what will you do with Jesus? If he fulfilled all these prophecies, is he the Savior? The third point we want to bring this morning is final resting place. So we had the final words, final breath, and now final resting place. And first of all, we have here the funeral directors. There's two of them mentioned. One's Joseph of Arimathea. He's never mentioned before or afterwards in the book of John. This is the only time he's mentioned in the book of John. But in other places when he's mentioned, we get some other ideas about who he is and what he did and a little bit about him. Let me just read this sentence, and it's backed up with Matthew, Mark, and Luke if you want to read those three passages also. It says he was rich, devout, and a member of the Sanhedrin who had not consented to the plot to condemn Jesus and to have him crucified. In fact, it was he who gave his own tomb to have Jesus buried in. It was a new tomb. It had been there, and in Isaiah 53:9, now Jesus Christ was not a rich person. Mary, when Jesus Christ was born, brought two turtle doves because that's all she could afford. He was not a rich person. The ladies came along and supported him. He didn't have a bag of gold that supported him and his 12 disciples all the time. The ladies did things in order to support him in his ministry. So he was not rich. And yet Isaiah 53:9 says this, and if you're of Jewish heritage listening to this, may I encourage that you read Isaiah 53. Read Isaiah 53 and then honestly in your heart say, what does this tell me about the Messiah? Messiah, is it Jesus? Don't even let me tell you that you need to say it's Jesus at this point. Just read Isaiah 53 and then think about it. Who is the Messiah? But in Isaiah 53:9 it says, his grave was assigned with wicked men, yet he was a rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. Jesus Christ died with thieves, but was buried with the rich. And Joseph of Arimathea was a rich person. Then as we look at it's interesting, the opposites here. The disciples were public with Jesus, but when he was arrested and came to the cross, they deserted him. Joseph of Arimathea was a quiet and a silent disciple of Jesus. And when it came to the cross, he went public. So the disciples were public and went secret. Joseph of Arimathea was secret and went public. And the same is true for Nicodemus. Nicodemus was the other one. It says in the scriptures here, he was the one that came to Jesus by night. If you look back to John chapter 3, that famous verse, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That verse was spoken by Jesus to this man, Nicodemus. We believe, that at least I believe, that he became born again at that point. And then later on in John chapter 7, you find him defending Jesus in a quiet way at the Sanhedrin, saying, does the scripture say you should condemn a man? And he kind of comes to Jesus' defense in that particular moment. And so twice he's come to Jesus and talked to Jesus. He brings about, it says 100 pounds in the scriptures, but in U.S., by U.S. standards, that would be about 72 pounds of spices and funeral herbs and things that you would use in order to bury a person and to prepare for it. In verse 39 and 40, it talks about the body's preparation. So we have the funeral directors, then we have the body's preparation. In verse 39, it says, and Nicodemus came, who was come to him by night, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes. Now, where have you heard of myrrh before? Can you think? How about back to the Christmas story with Mary and Joseph and the wise men? They brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And I believe that gift of myrrh was a future-looking thing. It was very expensive and very important, but I think it was a symbol that Jesus Christ came as a baby to die as a man to save us from our sins. Myrrh was given. And so we have the myrrh here that was associated with Jesus Christ. In Matthew 2:11 is where you find the myrrh coming. And then the expensive ointments and things they used to perfume the body, because they didn't embalm bodies back then. It says in Matthew 26:6-12, if you look at that, it's the story of the woman who pours the perfume on Jesus. And Judas says, well, why wasn't that? And the disciples, why wasn't that sold? And the money put in the treasury to help help the poor people or something like that. And Jesus Christ responds to her these words, when she poured this perfume on my body, she did it to prepare me for burial. And that's this is the very occasion we're looking at. So everybody indeed confirmed Jesus was dead. The blood and the water coming from his side, the fact that he was buried by these three people and had all these spices and wrapped up in a cloth that went all over his body, he was dead. And then verses 40 and 41, the garden tomb had a low entrance. If you look, and Mary had to stoop to see inside in John chapter 20. There was a large stone rolled in front of it, according to Mark 16:4. And then in Matthew 27:66, it says there was a Roman seal put on it so that nobody would go in, and it was guarded by soldiers. This is the tomb, the garden tomb that we have. It says that it was in a garden. And Sean, if you could put those other two slides, let's just take a brief look at these slides. And I've seen this. I saw it back when I was a teenager and I had the privilege of going to the Holy Land. But if you look at this site, you can almost see a skull there if you look at that picture. And some people believe that this is the place. Now, we don't know that this is the place. Temple, or you might say a church that's over top of a place they think Jesus was crucified. It's inside the city gates, but people say at that time it was probably outside the city gates because the crucifixion would have taken place outside the city. So I'm not saying this is the place that he was crucified, but some think it is a good representation because you can see the skull there. And then you can see a couple of crevices in the rock. And if you go to the next picture, this is just a picture of what a tomb might look like there. A large rock. The one I saw was kind of down low into the ground, and the stone kind of rolled down into it. It wasn't as high up and as big as this. But this gives you a little bit of an idea of how the rock would be hewn out, and a grave would be placed in there, and the stone could be rolled across it. So this is the type of place where Jesus Christ was indeed buried. And when I think of the garden, I think of two gardens. I think of the Garden of Eden, which Adam and Eve were driven out of because of their sin. And then I think of the garden tomb here where Jesus was buried, which basically his death canceled out the first garden. So we have the first garden where we got sin, and we have the second garden where Jesus Christ took care of sin. And on Easter, we'll find that he was the victor over sin. Let me just read a couple of verses as we close here as we prepare for communion. One is from Revelation 1:7. It says, "Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him." Jesus Christ will come back again, and even those who pierced him will see. The fact that he was pierced is an important thing in the future. And then in Philippians chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, it says, "So that the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth, under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father." I don't know if you've ever heard of cryonics. It's the idea that we can freeze the person, freeze their brain, freeze their body, and at some point later in time, if they have a disease, when we find the cure, they're going to bring these people back to life and fix them. Kind of a far-out thing. I think 100 people or more have done it so far, and there's thousands of others signed up. But you know what? We can't cheat death. It is appointed unto to die, once to die, and after that, the judgment. So my question is, why wait? You're confronted today with the facts. Either Jesus was a fraud or he's your Savior, one of the two. He's a fraud or your Savior. These are the only two choices. In the face of death, like Jesus, who would lie and continue a deception? Who would fulfill all these prophecies from 1,000 years earlier, some of them? And that the time and place of his birth and the type and details of his death and burial would be said so far ago, and he would be able to, and he did, fulfill them all. 322 prophecies. Hebrews 3:13 and 15 encourages us with these words, "But encourage one another day after day, as long as it is still called today, lest any one of you be hardened by this deceitfulness of sin. Today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts." Savior and Lord, or fraud? Those are your two choices this morning. If you're watching this service this morning and do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, just wanted to go to church on Palm Sunday, we are thankful that you're here. But the question for you is Jesus Christ your Savior and Lord, or was he fraud? I hope you'll decide. As we close this morning, our theme is, Jesus Christ completed our salvation on the cross, and all we must do is believe. In this environment today with pandemic, you know, who knows about tomorrow? James 4:14 says, yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. You are just a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Whether you're young or old, we will all come to that place of making a decision. And our decision right now will determine our destiny. Eternal life doesn't start when you die. Eternal life starts today if you accept Jesus Christ. If you want to know more about this, use the website that our elder Ken brothers shared with you earlier. Write to us. We can send you some literature, some tracts. Give us a call. And we'd love to be able to talk with you or send you information that would help you decide on Jesus today. Now I'm going to ask Ken to come and serve us communion as we continue to think of the great agony and the price that Jesus Christ paid on behalf of you and me. Ken.
All right, so as we enter this communion time in a very unique way, I invite you all, and even if you're at home by yourself and it's just you, where two or more are gathered in my name, there am I, and you're with us. So here in the sanctuary, just to give you a little bit of a picture, as we take communion, the matzah for the bread is part of the Jewish Passover celebration. Has some very special significances and meanings. And so I invite you again on Thursday to join us with Model to go through and look at and study and understand some of those things a little bit more. But at your home, if you have that, like us, oddly, or if not, if you have some other bread that you have and you're going to be breaking it and sharing it among yourselves in a special celebration, that's wonderful. Wash your hands, especially in this season, but one of the things before you eat. So as we partake, we will be doing that, and then we will be having the cup as well. So most of you obviously would not have the little communion cups, but that's not required. Pastor Gary's using one of the regular drinking cups with some grape juice in it. And I actually found out there's different sizes of those communion cups because the first ones I grabbed wouldn't fit in the holes, and so Sean got one of those. So as we partake here, we invite you to join us in this as well, because on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread and said, "This is my body, which is given for you." So if you have your bread, let's get it ready and let's pray and say, Father, we thank you that your body was bruised, it was broken, and Lord, it was pierced. And we thank you that we have that representation and reminder in the matzah, and that's why we use it. But Father, we thank you that you are the bread of life, and that you have given us life when we trust in you. And Lord, we believe. We don't have to go to great extents. We don't have to make ourselves clean. We don't have to climb some high mountain or do some phenomenal task. We thank you, though, that you've done it all, that we can believe in you, and that, Lord, then we can go and serve others and do all of these great things in your name. So be with us during this time as we remember your body was broken. And so may we all now take and eat of it, Lord. Amen. Thank you. And after the supper, he took the cup, and he said, "This cup is the covenant of the new blood, or the new covenant in my name. Drink you all of it, and we remember the blood of Christ as we take this cup now." Also read that afterwards they sang a song and went out, but we're going to wrap up our service here with some music and go out perhaps in prayer today instead of physically going out. But if you know someone in need, definitely help them during this time. And with that, we thank you for joining us today.
Last night I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem, beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. Then I thought my dream was changed, the streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the morn was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark how the angels sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna.